which they shouldn't have been able to in the first place, but that's a whole other debate.
Hi, I'm Jonathan.
Hi, I'm Jack.
And I was going to sneak ahead of everybody, but I'll still be the caboose and say, I'm Lauren.
Well, you're not really the caboose because I'm John and I'm in the back today.
Thou chicka, wait, what?
Uh-huh.
And we are Glib Shark, and apparently 80% of Dungeons & Dragons end drunks. Today is recording on April 5th, 2016. Happy birthday to Spam Man. And I want to give a little quick shout out for T.O. Uncon. Tickets are on sale now at T-O-U-N-C-O-N.com. Fun for the whole family, or at least the whole internet family.
And hey, if anybody is listening to this and is going to be in Seattle this weekend for Emerald City Comic Con, I'm not going because I have to work like crazy hours this whole weekend, but I'm going to try to maybe get out to Seattle in late in the evening. Shoot me up a message. Send me a message on Twitter and let me know you're in town so that we can meet up.
There you go. And if you happen to be at Emerald City Comic-Con, go see hi to Jay and Miles from Jay and Miles Explain the X-Men. Aside from the podcast we do here, it's one of my very favorites. And tell them Jack Edithill sent you. See how they react.
Hey.
Poorly.
But first, as always, or at the very least as often as we can, we have the lovely, the talented, the amazing, the exceptional Oboe Crazy here to do a little something that we call This Week in Geek. How are you, Lauren?
I have a bottle of Jack Daniels next to me, and it's delicious. I only have two things to talk about in This Week in Geek this week, because we just recorded an episode of Dungeons & Dragons & Drunks, which you can find at Dungeon Drunks or on this very podcast. So I'm a little tired. But hey, two fun things to talk about. You probably got the Blu-ray for Star Wars The Force Awakens, or if you didn't, you know someone who did. Let's face it. Everybody loves Star Wars, and the Blu-ray came out today. To coincide with this release, Sphero has released an update to the BB-8 app. So you've probably seen it, the little tiny remote-controlled BB-8s that you can actually control with your phone. It's adorable. You can now download an update to the tiny droid so that it'll watch the movie along with you. Not only that, it'll react to what's happening on the screen with sounds and motion. So if you're having trouble finding somebody to watch The Force Awakens with you, now you can just stick BB-8 next to you and he'll just react along with you as though he's never seen the movie before. So once you've updated the app, you'll find a new entry among the various play modes called Watch With Me that gets BB-8 ready to enjoy the flick. You'll also need to make sure that the app has access to your device's microphone, since it's your smartphone or the tablet that'll be listening along, not the actual droid. Because sometimes magic is magic. For the best experience, you'll want to place the device running the Sphero app near your TV so it can hear what's going on. You'll want BB-8 perched on its dock in front of you so you can see it react. And you might want to plug it in because The Force Awakens is just over 2 hours and you want to watch it through all the way to the credits. It is adorable. You can see video out there of it and it's amazing. And it kind of makes me wish that I'd bought one of these things, except, you know, money. So
mine's basically a glorified cat toy, so I'm updating now so I have somebody to watch the movie with.
There you go. It's amazing and it's adorable. I have a friend who's got one of those things and it is just adorable. I love it. The other story I have is about a real droid. We're talking about NASA's Opportunity rover, which is out on Mars. And every once in a while, Opportunity sends back pictures or grainy videos or, you know, something reminding us that it's doing something kind of friggin' amazing. And recently, it was a dust devil. It doesn't seem like much. I mean, hey, it's a dust devil. We get those all the time on Earth, but it's a Martian dust devil. And Opportunity was actually able to capture an image of it, and it's one of the best ones that's ever been captured. NASA's Opportunity rover actually snapped the picture on March 31st, 2016. Like our planet, Mars features these columns of rotating hot air that pick up sand and dust all around them as they spin fast enough, making the vortex visible. The picture is actually pretty cool because the Martian rover had to turn its camera around to go look at it behind it. So you see its tracks through the Martian soil back to where this dust devil was. So it kind of looks like it's looking behind it as it runs from a really small tornado. It's kind of adorable. So dust devils have largely eluded opportunity during its missions. The twin rover Spirit managed to witness a number of them during its tenure on Mars, but these mini twisters are fairly common on the red planet. And so if you watched The Martian and you saw all those little tiny dust devils, yeah, that's actually kind of accurate. But you can now see the photo of actual Martian dust devils. There's something really special about that, seeing the real thing. Definitely go check out those pictures. That's all for this week on This Week in Geek. I'm oboe crazy, and I just want to keep looking at the... I kind of want BB-8 to sit next to me and look at these adorable pictures of Martian dust devils.
The world is indeed an adorable place. If you have a fact you want read live and on the air on this broadcast, you can send it to Lauren at oboecrazy.com, and she'll read it. And while you're at it, go to glibshark.com, home of episodes of our modern Glibshark, classic Jenga Jam with interviews with people like Chris Hastings and Carly Minardo, and, you know, buttcasts from back in the day with fledgling internet superstars like Barbara Dunkelman, Mary McDowell, and so on and so forth. And of course, our latest sensation, Dungeons and Dragons and Drunks, featured recently on the Dungeons and Dragons podcast with Greg Tito.
Yes, it was awesome. Although sadly, I've found out that my parents still haven't listened to the episode. I'm a little annoyed.
Aw.
I keep asking every week. I'm just like, hey, have you guys listened to the episode yet? Like, I mention my parents in the episode. I talk about you to the people who made Dungeons and Dragons on a podcast for all the people who play Dungeons and Dragons. And they're like, oh yeah, we're definitely going to listen to it. And it's been weeks. I love you, Mom and Dad.
Don't be like Lauren's parents. Listen to that show right now.
Oh, we had a lot of fun, which my parents will soon find out about once they listen.
Yeah, and you can have that fun right now. All you got to do is go to the Dungeons & Dragons podcast. Was it Wizards of the Coast? I'm trying to remember what the exact website would be.
If you just Google Wizards of the Coast or Google Wizards D&D. It's their official website. Give me 10 seconds and I'll give you an actual URL.
All right, while we're waiting for those 10 seconds, we're
joined. It'll be less than that. It's wizards.com. Go to wizards.com. That's the Wizards of the Coast website. Go to the Dungeons and Dragons area and go check out their podcast, and you can find me. I'm in the URL.
And speaking of Dungeons and Dragons and Drunks, we are joined by none other than the one, the only, the amazing...
Jonathan the Magic Muscular.
Well, no, he's always here. I'm talking about Carlton Tanks, the surprisingly literate Carlton Tanks, the only one who remembers people's names when he puts his mind to it, that is. How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing well. I smash things with axes, and it goes well for me. Yeah, dude. There's a benefit of being a tank sometimes.
Absolutely. Gosh, I mean, I'm thinking all the times you've saved our bacon. It's just like, although, I feel like there's a mutual bacon... We're like a mutual bacon-saving admiration society.
It's like a bacon-saving factory.
Yeah, bacon-saving factory. Can we call ourselves that, the bacon-saving factory?
As a Jew, please no.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
It's not my group, so I'm just...
Yeah. It has like a cool, like, 70s vibe to it. Right, but you have control
over what happens to us, so if we kind of pick a name that you don't like, maybe we encounter some stuff that doesn't go our way. Just say it.
I'm not that vindictive, mostly.
They mostly come out at night. Mostly.
Although, we do take pun damage, which is something that has tempered my style of gameplay.
Jonathan, yes. The Magic Muscular disregards possible pun damage.
Oh, clearly. You're worse at it than I am. I would say lately, if you take the last 10 episodes of D&D, you're more of a pun guy than I am at this point.
Oh, absolutely.
I feel like I've just grown tired of throwing damage at you because it hasn't worked. So I just do it in more subtle ways.
It's not a deterrent. Except when you get covered in things that you don't want to be covered in. Which seems to happen at Travancore a lot more often than I might like. I mean, I love the juxtaposition of the fact that he's supposed to be this sort of, you know, dignified, quasi-royal figure, but yet he's constantly subjected to this this debasement, this endless indignity by disingenuous mountebanks.
I did want to mention that I did buy Star Wars on... Pardon me.
Cough right.
No dying.
Yeah, no dying. I did buy Star Wars on digital on Friday, and So on Friday night, we had a little bit of a Star Wars date, and it was cool. It was a lot of fun to watch it again. I'd only see it like twice in the theater, so seeing it at home for a third time was really, really neat.
Nice. Yeah, I've only seen it the once in the theater, and then I think Luke has a digital copy now. So I think I've seen it over his shoulder while he's been drawing, while he's been watching it while drawing, but I've really only seen it the once.
Yeah, I saw it once at theaters, and now I have the Blu-ray on order. Should be getting here in a day or two.
Yeah, great. I thought about maybe actually picking up the Blu-ray. I don't think I will right now, but having it on digital is fine for me because I can play it anywhere, and it's good.
Well, what I usually do is I just rip the copies to digital that I have on the Blu-ray. That way I can watch it mobily or whatever. And a lot of times the Blu-rays come with a digital copy. But there's times I want all the bonus features, especially something like Star Wars. I'm going to want the bonus features.
That is becoming more and more common for the digital versions to be included. Or not even a digital version. Sometimes the Blu-ray is a Blu-ray DVD digital combo just to get all of your needs.
Yeah.
Which is nice. I have not been watching movies because I just am not a movie person. I have been doing a lot of reading lately, though, which I'd felt bad in the last couple of months. I feel like I've really gotten off the reading train. And then with all of the Critical Role that I've been watching, they've been talking about Brandon Sanderson, who is the he's an author who the most recent book of his has cover art. In where one of the characters basically looks like Matthew Mercer. So they've been having fun with that. And then, so like the name had been rolling around in my head. And then out of nowhere, one of my good friends on Halo mentioned him and how much of a fan he was of his books. And I said, oh, I've heard this guy from Critical Role. And so I have actually bought his book. So Brandon Sanderson, one of his first series is called Mistborn. It's a 3-book series and the first book is actually called Mistborn, and I just finished that book the other day and have started working on book 2, and I have to say I've been very impressed. It is a surprisingly quick read, even though it doesn't feel like a quick read. Like it's got a good lore and a really interesting magic system and really fun characters. But it dives just deep enough into everything so that you feel like you know these people and you know this world and you know what's going on, but it doesn't go lore crazy. So action and plot happen very quickly, even though you're also getting explained the world. So highly recommend. I will be moving on to finishing book 2 as quickly as I can.
Yeah, I read Sanderson's, what is it? The Words of Radiance series. I'm trying to remember which one it is. It's a really good one. All of Sanderson's stuff takes place in the same like cosmic deal. So you'll have like if a creature is powerful enough, it'll show up in multiple Sanderson stories or Sanderson series. I know there's at least one that has come over to the Word of Kings Way of Kings. Okay. And that one, that series has been really, really awesome. I've read the first 2 books, and I don't know when the third one is coming out, but Sanderson is a really prolific writer. I also read his Steelheart novella, and that was really good too.
Yeah, that everything you said has been echoed by a lot of the other people, especially my friend Sarge, who had recommended this to me, that he is prolific, but high quality. That his whole universe is it's one big universe, even if there's not obvious connections because it's totally different stories. And basically, because when I'd asked, I said, well, what book should I start with? And then I gave the caveat, if you're going to give me a series, I don't mind if you give me a 3, 5, even 10 book series. But right now what I want is a complete series. Give me something with an end. Don't give me another Game of Thrones to read. And he's like, no. The good thing about, you know, Sanderson is that if he says he's going to finish a book, he's going to fucking finish that book. You don't have to worry about it. But yeah, that was one of the reasons I started with Mistborn, is he said it was an excellent introduction to that world and those characters. And it was a complete series. So yeah, thumbs up. Would recommend. I think Stormlight Archive is the other one that I've heard.
Stormlight Archive, that's the one I've read. The first one is Way of Kings, And then Word of Radiance is the second book. And apparently the third book is going to be Oathbringer, which is coming out in 2017.
Okay. So yeah, prolific and consistent. There you go. I'm trying to remember what the name of the book was. I actually saw it in the Barnes & Noble that I was at, because I was trying to decide if I did I really want to go with the one that had Matt Mercer on the cover, or did I want to go... Here, I'm gonna pull it up real quick. Here we go. The Bands of Mourning. Apparently, if you see the cover for The Bands of Mourning, check out the guy that's on the cover. It's Matt Mercer. It is. It's kind of fun. I want to have that experience one day of looking at a book cover of a book that I've never seen before and be like, that kind of looks like me. I think I was just cast on a book.
My buddy's father-in-law is, if you've ever played Magic the Gathering and have run into the card Soldevi Simulacrum, that's my buddy's father-in-law.
The actual picture?
The actual picture.
Is that on purpose, or is yes, it one of those happy coincidences?
No, he was the artist who made that particular card was friends with him and used him as a model.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Does he play Magic?
I don't know that he does anymore.
Because I gotta say, if I was the art on a Magic card, I'd play Magic everywhere. And I don't care that I would be bad at it, but I would play that card as quickly as possible.
He is, I'm not sure if he has or still does play. He may, because my buddy is a big fan of Magic, and I know his kids have played. So it's very possible that since they all live in the same house, the same giant fucking house, that that they had played Magic with the kids before.
Okay. Esoteric question, gentlemen. Mm-hmm. If you were a Magic card, tell me what kind of Magic card you would be. Describe what's your mana pool, what's your stats? Give me it.
I would be a dual land, because everyone fucking wants a dual land.
Okay, what land though?
I'd probably be an underground lake, so black blue.
You know, I kind of want to just be green, because I like being a giant creature.
I'd be a black lotus because I'm so money.
I want to be a giant creature with trample. I want to be something pretty but dangerous.
I would be a blue-eyes white dragon.
I was going to make that joke too, but I want to
one. And don't tell me I can't, because I believe in the heart of the cards.
I want to be a Charizard then.
No, I'm gonna stick with my trample. I just want to be. I never even really got into Magic, but I've never gotten into any of those card games. So I know enough to be intelligent about talking about them. But that's about it.
I mean, I know the basic rules of it, but I haven't really played actively in about 18 years. So
Jenga, ooh. You and I might be, playing with you might be one of the few times I've ever actually played Magic outside of a video game, because I remember us, I want to say it was at PAX East, waiting for the Rooster Teeth panel to start.
Yep.
That was the first time. Yeah.
And we were sitting on the floor waiting for the thing to start, and we opened up those Planeswalker packs, and I think you might have actually taught me how to play Magic in that moment.
Yeah, I can't imagine it was the only time I've ever played. Oh man, that's crazy.
Yeah.
But I wanted to play, but I played it on borrowed decks, and I realized very quickly in order to get good at it, you have to keep buying more and more cards, and I just noped on out. I'm like, nope, 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 nope. Do not want. Best of luck to you if it's your thing, but it's not mine. Of course, I went on to buy comic books.
I'm constantly surprised by how far Luke is able to get in Hearthstone without buying any cards.
Man. Yeah, I actually just bought the pre-order pack for the next expansion. So, that reminds me. I need to actually set my card back, because they're letting people set the special card back from that pre-order. And it's got little eyeballs and stuff. And that's part of the reason why I did the pre-order, was because I wanted that particular card back, because it was cool.
Are those kind of things something that the player, your opponent can see, or only you
can
see?
Yes, the opponent can see your card back.
Even if they don't own that card back?
Yeah.
Okay, that's cool.
Yeah, there's a couple. There's one that like has these like blue and gold like gears on it. It's really neat looking. But I think that was a probably a reward from something else, like either a pre-order or like a reward from a different game. There's actually a paladin that you can get that's like a sort of a paladin skin. And if you get to level 20 in League of Legends, or not League of Legends, but World of Warcraft, then that is a reward that you can get in Hearthstone. And I think there's a card back, like if you pre-order Overwatch, you can get a card back for that too.
Ah, Blizzard, tying all of their shit together like smart people.
Yeah, I actually had a pretty good run on Hearthstone today on the treadmill. I won 3 games. I got to 18, just went from 20 to 18 just right away. And one game I got a turn 4 concede, which I was very happy about.
I've been playing a lot of Avengers. I just lost the name of the game. Avengers Alliance 2 actually just came out, and that has become my treadmill game. And it's fun. I haven't found the depth yet, but I also haven't found the paywall yet. So I'm kind of waiting for that moment to see what happens. And I do notice in the chat, we've got a splash screen for Quantum Break. Is that just because it's coming out?
Yes, it came out today and I got to play it a little.
Ah, tell us about your Quantum Break experience.
So far, it's been pretty good. It's a little strange because you have time powers and you shoot stuff. So I'm still working that out. I haven't actually played all that much because pretty much I came home, I made a little dinner, I got to play for like an hour, 45 minutes, and then we started on Dungeons & Dragons Drunks. I do have training tomorrow, so I don't have to wake up quite as early, so I might play it a little bit after we get done here. But so far, it's been pretty interesting. It's apparently a choose-your-own-adventure, so there are going to be breaks in the story where you can go one way, but your friend may choose a different path. So I'm looking forward to playing the different iterations of the story.
And who's cooler, Littlefinger or the Hobbit?
So far, they both look pretty creepy, so I would have to say the Hobbit so far.
Okay. Have you reached any of the live-action cutscenes?
No,
I guess it's not cutscenes. Okay. Yeah, I guess it's not really cutscenes is short selling it. Apparently there are like 30-minute TV episodes depending on your choices in the middle of this game.
Yeah, I was actually talking to a friend of the show, Izzy, and she had gotten a little bit farther. And so she was I think she was watching one of the live action scenes last I checked. So that's something I'm looking forward to getting to because they approach it not like cutscenes, but yeah, like actual episodes where you can stop, you can pause, you can rewind. And so if you miss something, you can go back and get it.
I am interested in it, but I don't have the money right now for another game. I have been playing, Luke and I have continued to play Wolf Among Us, which came out for free games for those of us with gold. So we just last night did episode 2 of all 5 and I got drunk and we played through that. So that's been a lot of fun. Which is a total choose your own adventure, but no shooting. And then Luke has been going through afterwards. So we've been playing together and kind of making decisions together, although I'm the one with the controller, so it tends to go more good. Especially since with Wolf Among Us, you have to make the decisions fairly quickly. It gives you a timer. And then he's been going back afterwards on his account and replaying the mission and being kind of an evil bastard. So it's been fun to see the differences. Or what isn't different, depending on what choices that he's been making. Django, you been playing anything new?
Well, it's funny you should ask. I recently got... I saw a deal, and I was able to pick up a Dragon Age Inquisition, which I know isn't very new. But here's the thing. There was an electrical storm here a couple of days ago, and now my Xbox One is on the fritz.
Ooh.
So I'm going to try it after the show to see if I can get it to work again. If not, it's under warranty at least, so I can take it to the Best Buy, have them take a look at it, see if there's an issue with the HDMI cable, if it's my TV, or if it's the Xbox. But I'm looking forward to it. Well, apparently it doesn't detect it, like, on the TV. Like, I plug it in, I turn it on, and it doesn't detect it. I plug it into the other TV, and it works just fine, and the other HDMI stuff works on this TV. But for some reason, the Xbox One isn't being recognized. So it might just be as simple as an HDMI cable. Could be something more advanced. Keep in mind, my TV is also about 7 or 8 years old. So it might be time to upgrade.
Yeah, but, it might be the TV. I mean, if you're able to put that on a different TV and it works just fine.
Well, I wouldn't say just fine. It was all like faded and stuff. I'd do that whole like when you hold down the power button and the eject button resets the whole like dealy.
Oh.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. So I think it's just a screen format that it does. I don't think it's like a factory reset. At least I hope it's not. I have, well, most of my stuff is cloud storage. I should be okay.
Yeah.
But it's been a crazy couple of days. I mean, in Philadelphia especially, like just the preparation for the NCAA basketball tournament. Not to go to sports too much, but my old college, Villanova, has won the national championship. So I was
about to say you're entitled to go into sports as much as you want at this point.
All right. Well, I'll gloss over briefly because I know our audience.
Sports.
Yes. Ball. So sports ball, my brother actually came down from Long Island. We went to campus. We watched the game together at a place called Connolly Center, which is like their student center kind of place. They also had people at the normal place they play basketball, but that place was packed. So I didn't want to watch in a huge crowd. So my brother and I just watched the whole game. And that was a nail biter of a game. It was so back and forth. And the thing that I keep coming back to is how unselfish the players are, how like just team oriented they are. They'll give up their own opportunities to help somebody else out to make sure that they do what they do. At one point, one of our guys was even like mopping the floor to make sure that the mop was okay because he knew he had to do it properly. I think it was Ochefe. And man, Ryan Archie Diacono, man, that kid is just incredible. Just at the end, he had the opportunity to make the shot, but he's like, nah, I'll give it to my teammate. And he nailed it the very last possible second. And it was touch and go. For a while there, I felt like it was slipping away from me. And then a funny thing happened on the way to losing. You won.
I had actually forgotten that the game was on. And then when I sat that down and looked at Twitter and stuff, I'm like, oh, crap, that's going on like right now. So I turned it on. I like turned on the stream. And that was right before the Tar Heels made that one three-pointer to tie it with like 5 seconds left. And then, so I'm like, oh my God, I hadn't been watching this game, but I'm so interested. And yeah. Then that last three-pointer to the buzzer beater to win it was just phenomenal. I actually threw up my arms in celebration because of the moment. Like,
yeah.
Like if you were to want the end of a game to go any more dramatically, that's how you want to do it. And a lot of people were saying after the game that it's an instant classic, and I totally agree.
It's, objectively speaking, one of the best, if not the best, basketball game I've ever watched. I don't think that's hyping it much at all. It was totally balanced. It was back and forth. It was tit for tat balance. There was drama. There was suspense. There was Michael Jordan in the background. And I got to say in your face, Michael Jordan. And of course, he became a meme. Crying Jordan took off, mine didn't, but what a great town for not just the university and the alumni and the students, but for the whole area, really. I mean, at one point, all of Philadelphia, who ordinarily all the basketball teams here hate each other, so you know, St. Joe's, LaSalle, Temple, they're all part of the Big Five along with Villanova, and at the end, like most of them were galvanizing around the idea that hey, if one of us win, we all win, and that's a wonderful thing. And
sports.
The proceeding has been a presentation of Glib Sports, I guess.
That's okay. I may not watch sports at all, but I do agree with Jonathan and where that's your team. Those are your peeps. You have every right to talk about that kind of thing.
Talk to me come baseball season.
Yeah, well, that's now. Pitchers and catchers are reported. The regular season already started.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
I'm terrible at this.
I don't know. Well, to be fair, the nearest professional baseball team to you now is like what, like 3 hours away?
Yeah, either Houston or Dallas.
Or the Rangers, yeah.
Which both are AL teams and Phillies are an NL team.
Right. But the Phillies,
I was like, it's going to take a... When I moved down here, I was like, oh, I can watch the Phillies play Houston. But that was the year Houston switched leagues. I went, oh, fuck you.
But now there's interleague play like all year. So it's not like it's a rare thing for the NL to play the AL anymore.
Or I just come back to Philly to go to the ball games, which is what I'm doing in May. So
well, there you go. Like I want to go to a game this year. Like I missed out on it last year. And I feel like the Phillies are starting to turn a corner a little bit. Like it's going to take a couple of years for them to build back. But at least we have the taste of failure. Like, you know, we have a chance to move on from...
That just shows you that I'm not a fair weather fan.
From the dark days of Ruben Amaro. Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's if you hung out this long, then yeah.
I liked him in the 90s. I liked him in the early 2000s. And I liked him in the late 2000s.
Yes.
I had that bell curve.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not an easy thing to be a Philadelphia sports fan. I'll tell you that much.
It's also not easy if you've been investing your money via a Panamanian law firm. Your world has gotten turned upside down a little bit.
Oh, yeah, the whole Panama Papers thing.
How great of a name is that?
The Panama Papers.
Yeah, like it is a
Tom Clancy novel. Let's face it.
Like, when it comes down to the history books, like, that name, perfect. Like, shot heard around the world, all that stuff, it's going to be Panama Papers.
Yeah, a lot of people call me down this week. The Prime Minister of Iceland already resigning. Looks like the Tories in England. Like, I think David Cameron's dad is involved somehow.
They were saying that Messi was involved too, the soccer player.
Yeah, it's
so far reaching, and it is. They were saying like just as far as like the size of the. Of the files that were turned over, like what, something like 11 terabytes?
Something like that. It's, and the really weird thing is, the explanation that Vox gave, I thought was the best thing possible. So Vox, the Explain the News website, they sort of said, well, imagine, you know, you have a piggy bank, and your friend lets you keep your piggy bank over there. And maybe it's because you're trying to hide money for your mom, maybe it's because your brother bullies you and take your money. But regardless, this kid has this idea to start housing other people's piggy banks. Trouble is, this isn't allowed, and his mom finds out, and everyone gets in trouble. The neighborhood gets in trouble, and that's basically what happened. In a nutshell,
that's why I keep my money under my mattress.
Well, you can invest in a bank, just don't do it in like a Panamanian bank with no.
Just don't do it in you can't do tax evasion. That's essentially what all this is. Is like, it's just billions of dollars that should have been going to governments that aren't. And so that's, it's a big deal. And so many people are going to come down for it. It's like, I think there were a couple officials. Yeah, there were a couple officials in Brazil that are named in the documents. And those guys were already in trouble because of the whole Olympic fiasco.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of crazy with Brazil. It's like, how could they get in any more trouble? Oh, they kept some money in Panama.
We'll find a way.
It's like Hulk Hogan always says, take your vitamins, say your prayers, pay your taxes.
And while Glib Shark is not a accredited accountant and should not be giving you tax advice, in these last 10 days before the end of the tax season, we do advise you, don't do anything illegal.
I'm not going to lie. I may have asked my accountant about setting up a business in Ireland. So because since I'm self-employed, I have to pay that additional self-employed tax. And I'm like, it's not fair. Facebook and everybody else doesn't have to pay it.
Yeah.
So
maybe we determined that on a podcast.
Not doing illegal things is probably best.
Yeah.
See, but his accountant said, that's a bad idea because that's illegal. And then he said, okay, then I won't do it because I would never do anything illegal.
Yeah. Because your job is to keep me out of jail.
Exactly. Hey, I have breaking news in the world of Dungeons and Dragons if we'd like to move on to slightly happier topics.
All right. Oh, yeah.
So if you watch the Geek and Sundry Twitch channel on Friday, April 8th, from 4:30 to 6 p.m., you can watch a sloth play D&D. That's right.
That's my spirit animal.
A sloth. So apparently after hitting 16,000 subscribers on their Twitch channel, Geek and Sundry is bringing Sid the Sloth, which is, yes, his real name, to the Geek and Sundry offices, and they are going to play D&D with Sid the Sloth. It will include the crew from Critical Role and Felicia Day, as well as some other guests, and it will be broadcast live to commemorate the illustrious day of interspecies role-playing. There will be sloth t-shirts for sale, with a portion of the proceeds going to the Wildlife Learning Center charity, which is the home of Sid the Sloth. So yeah, that's hashtag sloth and sundry, and that's April 8th, from 4:30 to 6 p.m. Pacific time. Go see a sloth. Play D&D.
So I have 5 sloth t-shirts already, no lie, and I think I need to add a 6th one.
There you go. I don't know if you can already buy this t-shirt. It doesn't look like it yet. I would definitely keep an eye on geekandsundry.com because at least as far as their Critical Role t-shirts go, when they put those things up on sale, they go away super fast. I am still really bitter about the fact that I don't have a Gilmore's Glorious Goods t-shirt, partially because I wasn't there to buy one, mostly because I don't have any money. Hey, if anyone ever wants to buy me something, buy me a Critical Role t-shirt. I will be really happy. But yeah, so Friday, apparently you can add to your sloth. Okay, wait, now I need to back up. Why do you have a sloth t-shirt collection?
So the reason I have sloth 5 sloth t-shirts was I bought one on Woot, and it was a sloth with like stunner shades with fireworks in the background. It was awesome. And then I bought another one off of Woot with the little baby sloth in the pocket. I'm like, all right, that's good. But then Drunk John was like, nah, you need to have a sloth shirt for every day of the working week. And so he went out and bought 3 more. Live Slow, Die Whenever, 3 Sloth Moon, and then, what's the last one? So, okay, sloth. Sloth Baka. So it's like a sloth dressed like Chewie.
I want to live in your life.
It's my spirit animal, man. Live slow, die whenever.
I want to be a sloth fan like you.
They're so adorable. I love it.
They do have giant claws. I mean, I do agree there that they're adorable.
There is a pet shop in Austin that has a store mascot that is a sloth, and you can go and see it and visit it. You cannot buy it, I have asked.
Well, no, because I don't think sloths are legal as pets.
They are in Texas.
Well, that's because it's Texas.
That's because it's Texas.
That's because it's Texas. Glib Shark does not condone nor approve of you having a sloth as a pet.
No, they are very difficult pets, and that's why they had one at the store. Was somebody's like, oh, I want a sloth pet, and then they got it, and they're like, I can't take care of this. This is really difficult. Here, you have it.
Yeah.
This happens parents. Every time we have Sedlak on, man. Like, I feel like we double the number of disclaimers we normally do, or triple them. Glib Shark does not advocate the unauthorized practice of law. Just kidding. Secret lawyers meeting after the show.
Just don't do anything I say. Just as a word of advice, don't believe a word out of my mouth. Don't do anything I say. You're probably better off.
Sloths.
Except buy more sloth shirts, especially if they benefit charities and shit.
Well, yeah.
I've also planned trips to Costa Rica to go visit the sloth sanctuary.
Oh, man. Have you been?
I didn't even know there was a sloth sanctuary.
Oh, my God. So many adorable baby sloth videos from there.
Oh, well. Back when I was the rest of my internet usage.
Back when I used to work in Philly, when I was having like a bad day at the office, my student workers would just like put on baby sloth videos for me and like tuck me in the corner. Be like, all right, John, here, you watch some sloth videos and don't let anybody talk to you because you're going to make somebody cry because you're in a bad mood.
All right.
Make adults cry.
It was I have done it, even though I will regret it. I have Googled bath time for baby sloths.
Oh, my God.
Actually,
oh my God.
What I Googled was baby sloth videos, and I am now watching Animal Planet's Bath Time for Baby Sloth.
Oh, my God. It's so adorable. I know exactly which one you're talking about. I got it. It's too cute.
I'm going to stop watching because then all I'm going to do is going to be watching baby sloths. But yeah, there you go. So this Friday, more sloths.
Can we just make our Glib Shark panel a baby sloth watching party?
As our friend Corey would say, oh my God.
Jenga, as long as it's just we're watching videos of baby sloths and don't actually have to coordinate having a real life sloth in. Although I will say, if we're able to somehow magically coordinate having a sloth at our panel,
so
I think we will be a sold out.
Oh my God.
It's so I
cute.
Think Esther Cirola came up with the best idea for an RTX panel.
Sloths?
Where it's basically like, no. Which basically, she's just going to eat lunch for an hour. We get to watch her.
Yeah. People would go.
I want frontline seats. I'll give VIP pass if that was an approved panel.
I'm
only kind of joking. I'd do it.
Sorry, what were you saying? I was watching baby sloths.
Exactly.
I would do it if I could eat lunch. I don't need to sit next to her or even anywhere near her, but I would do it if I could also eat lunch there. And then I could say I had lunch with Esther Cirola.
Actually, you know what a really good idea for an RTX panel would be?
What?
Sloths?
5 friends getting together and playing Dungeons & Dragons while drinking.
That's a good idea. We're doing that at a different panel.
Can we do it? Can we have it twice? Can we do it like as D&D and then Glibstruck, we do it with mimosas in the morning and we just like play again?
Play the exact same adventure a second time.
Or
this is not a Telltale game. You don't make different choices.
Or we play the same adventure from Reggie's perspective. And all four of us RP as Reggie. Hey, Reggie.
Roll to see if you eat grass. Roll to see if you cuddle with Shadow.
16.
I do not.
Wait, I got a plus two cuddling. I got a plus two cuddling bonus.
Cuddling bonus. No, I have a few things.
I appreciate cuddling.
I have a few things planned that are D&D related on the Glibshark panel, but I think Glibshark needs to stand at least semi on its own. I do have at least, I'll go ahead and tease it. I have a blooper-ish reel to go nice. On the Glibshark panel. It's not really bloopers. It's just stuff cut from all of our episodes for various and sundry reasons. And once we get to the last couple of weeks, I need to now cut it down because I think I have like 15 minutes worth of content and that's a little much.
And you know what? That bad fanfic contest, that's still open. If you have bad fanfic you want to submit and have us read at our panel, you can send it to latenitejenga@gmail.com. And I'll read it. And I might even read it out loud if it's at the panel if it's bad/good enough.
But not the whole thing. Like no. A select paragraph.
Yeah, I would say excerpts from some of the better selections. I'll pick the choice bits. It'll be like the bad fanfic greatest hits.
And by guys, bad, guys,
they're so cute.
Bad.
It's crying and making sounds and they get washed. It's so cute.
We've lost him. We've lost him to the sloth.
This is your fault.
It's not my fault. It's Geek and Sundry's fault.
He's in a sloth hole, guys. Sloth hole kills podcast dead.
Yep. The most adorable way possible.
You know, where's Jonathan at a time like this? We need to come up with an alternate for Jonathan, like Puppet Jonathan or something.
Why?
I don't know. I think the idea of a little puppet.
We call him Abuelo?
No, I don't think that'd be inappropriate.
But I did watch Amazon, or not Amazon, but Mozart in the Jungle this weekend.
Oh, how's that?
It's delightful. It is. It's oboe. You would like it because it's about an oboe player.
I know. I've watched the first episode and I can't hate watch that show. I refuse to.
You can't hate watch it?
Yeah, because all I see are the obvious moments when the actors are not really playing their instruments or the issues that they bring up that I'm like, that would never happen in a real orchestra. And I can't be that person. I don't want to be that person that ruins everybody else's fun with reality.
Well, and the thing is, first of all, the music is awesome. Like, it's such a quirky and wonderful show. But frankly, it made me sad because it reminded me of how I don't do music anymore. Of how I haven't played an instrument in so long. And there was an episode where one of the characters heard a little girl play the flute and was just so mesmerized by that. Like, he didn't care about anything. He just wanted to meet this little girl because he was so in awe of her talent. And that one hit some feels because it was, like I said, it was reminding me of like the joy of playing music. And that's just a joy that I don't have anymore.
And that's, I've heard from many people, surprisingly, as an oboist, people want to talk to me about Mozart in the Jungle. I wonder why. And I've studiously tried to avoid talking about it because of that, because all I can see are the nitpicky inconsistencies and issues. And if it's a fun show, or if it's a good show, or if you're getting something like that out of it, which is, you know, like the best compliment I think of this show can get, then who am I to ruin your fun? Who am I, you know, just because I can't get over the fact that, oh my God, what are you doing? That's not how you hold an oboe. Like, fuck it. No, that's not what this show really is about. So.
Right. It reminds me of how people try and make me watch things just because like D&D is in it. And I have never seen a show that did Dungeons & Dragons well. because I, for the same reasons that you don't like watching people pretend to play the oboe, and then there's ridiculous shit that would never happen in an actual orchestra or a professional environment like that. I have never seen a fictional portrayal of D&D where that shit didn't happen. In fact, I think the best portrayal of D&D on television was actually in Freaks and Geeks, and they only spent like 10 minutes doing it.
Nah, dude, it's the Dungeons and Dragons movie starring Marlon Wayans, man. That's the best portrayal.
I will say, at least Dungeons and Dragons...
I got drunk and watched it. It was terrible.
I mean, the good thing about portrayals of Dungeons and Dragons is I feel like you could get away with a bit more because one of the main tenets of D&D is the idea that anything can happen and anything is possible, and everybody's got house rules and things that they do that are different than the printed books. And, you know, so maybe you're playing a home variant or whatever. And, you know, but yeah, I do agree that that can get a little surprising. I mean, I've talked about how much I love Critical Role and how great of a show it is. And Matt home rules stuff all over the place. It's his own homebrew world. And I love it and I respect that. But even I was caught off guard on, you know, one episode in where something happened and where I was very... He was playing, his NPC was a monk, a very high level monk. And his monk did an action that I'm very familiar with what that action does. And it didn't do what I was expecting. And I had the moment of like, wait, what? You know, but he needed that to do something else and it worked for the story, and that's absolutely fine. So at least in D&D, you can kind of get away with that, and where the answer to, well, that's not how it works is, well, it's my game.
Well, but like, no one has done something that subtle. It's always it's always a very gross misinterpretation of either the game or the players. And it's not something I appreciate.
And Mozart in the Jungle is the same thing for me. I can't look at...
I can see that.
Yeah, the very first... And the sad thing is they have such amazing guest stars. And Bernadette Peters is one of my favorite people of all time.
She is ageless.
I love her so much. She is gorgeous and talented and funny and amazing. And I want to appreciate her. Except... every time I have to watch the orchestra and I see the principal cellist not knowing how to hold a bow, or I watch as the actors just are, it's because they do such a good job of hiring real musicians to fill the gaps. It makes it that much more obvious that the non-musicians don't know what they're doing. And so I'll take a step back, but I'm super glad you enjoy it. And if what you're getting out of it is that rekindling love for either playing or listening, because either is valid. You do not have to play an instrument. Like, it's cool if you do, and I encourage everybody to try it. But honest to God, like, we musicians need people to listen to their music. And listening and appreciating is just as valid of participation in that art form as actually playing that instrument. So go see a concert. Go, you know, and it doesn't have to be even... you know, your biggest symphony orchestra in the area. Go see like a community orchestra that's going to have super cheap tickets. Go watch a concert on the lawn as we get into the summer season. There's like free concerts usually everywhere. Go do something like that. And you're participating in that artistic event. All right, rant over. I'm going to leave and go play Halo.
That's probably a good place to wrap up for tonight.
is oboe rant.
The proceeding has been an oboe crazy oboe rant. Yeah. I guess.
In where I say, go enjoy the shit that you enjoy. It's all good.
Jenga, and go watch Baby Sloth videos.
And Baby Sloth videos. Jenga, want to take us out?
Our sound producer is Jonathan, full of legal disclosures this episode. Serna.
Jonathan the Magimuscular here. Don't hire a gnoll to do your legal work. They are insane and evil and not board certified.
And thanks to our special guest, John Sedlak. You can follow him at Twitter, at ThatFilmGuy.
That'd be me.
Cool beans, man. And you can listen to him, of course, as Carlton Tanks on Dungeons & Dragons & Drunks right here on this broadcast. Our sound producer is Jonathan Cerna. I already said that. Our voice
actor.
That's
okay. It was a lot of work, and he deserves to get the credit twice.
That's true. So Bob Ball is a voice actor, and he does the opening for our announcer, actually. Our theme music is done by Linnea Boyev. On behalf of Jonathan Cerna.
Also, Lauren, happy birthday, Linnea.
And happy birthday, Lauren.
Thank you.
And on behalf of Jonathan Cerna, Lauren Urban, and the entire Glib Shark staff, and the D&D staff too, this time around, this is Jack Edithel saying good night, good health, and... Oh, man.
Go Villanova.
Go off on. Yeah.
Nova.
V for Villanova, V for victory, kids.